Hey folks, this is Abel James, and thanks so much for joining us on the Fat Burning Man Show, where we talk about real food and real results. Will fasted workouts make your muscles fall off? What are the benefits of long-term fat adaptation? How can we age in reverse? To answer these questions and more, I'm honored to say that returning to the show today is the OG fat burning beast and ultimate frisbee warrior, our friend Mark Sisson. Mark is, of course, a New York Times best-selling author, blogger over at Mark's Daily Apple, and the creator of the Primal Blueprint and Primal Kitchen. You're going to dig this show. But before we get there, here's a review for the Wild Diet audiobook that recently came in from Audible. They rate it 5 out of 5 stars and say a must-read, easy to understand, gives you a new, although ancient, way to look at the food we consume. For example, I've always thought my breakfast was healthy because I'd usually have almond milk with honey brand cereal. And when I looked at the ingredients and realized how much sugar I was consuming so early in the morning and how bad it was for me, I understood why it has been so hard to get rid of my spare tire despite doing so much effort in the gym and kitchen. Hey, thanks so much for writing that review. When I wrote The Wild Diet, which is now back in 2014, many years ago, I really wanted you to have pretty much everything you need to know in one place, as well as some recipes to get you started. The main principles to help you take your health into your own hands with real food and practical movement based on the movement of our ancestors. And we're going to dig in a lot more today on why breakfast might not be the best idea for some people. And we're going to be talking about intermittent fasting and intermittent eating with Mark as well. So thank you so much for leaving a review for the book. Even after all these years, I appreciate hearing from you, and I really hope that The Wild Diet is a resource that can help you and your family and friends for many years to come. But if you'd like added accountability, new tools and gadgets, and fun, then make sure to check out our new monthly challenge, The Wild Challenge, over at fatburningman.com/app. That's APP. You'll get to meet me, my wife, and the whole team, as well as our giant community now. We have an international community of people who have joined the challenge from all across the globe. So make sure that you get in the fun. We have basically meal plans laid out for you. We can hook in with your Fitbits and all those techie gizmos. We can track intermittent fasting, meditation, and much, much more. The new app is really robust. So if you're interested, check out The Wild Challenge. And don't forget to use the code WILD25. That's the number 25 attached to the word WILD. WILD25 is the promo code when you go there for 25% off our next challenge. So one last time, if you're interested, just head on over to fatburningman.com/APP to join our next Wild Challenge. And we're going to be giving away a lot of goodies from Wild Superfoods, as well as huggable bacon plushies and signed copies of Designer Babies Still Get Scabies, my international bestseller, the New York Times bestseller, The Wild Diet, and much, much more. So go check out the Wild Challenge. All right, on to this show with Mark Sisson. We're chatting about long-term benefits of becoming a fat-burning machine, why many of us were tricked by breakfast marketing propaganda, how to throw it into overdrive and kick into sweet potato mode, why fasted workouts will not make your muscles fall off, how to boost productivity and creativity with micro-workouts, and tons more. Let's go hang out with Mark. Welcome back, folks. Today, I'm honored to have Mark Sisson returning to the show. Mark is the New York Times best-selling author, blogger over at Mark's Daily Apple, and the creator of the Primal Blueprint and Primal Kitchen. Mark is also, of course, the OG fat-burning beast and ultimate frisbee warrior. Mark, thanks so much for coming on the show again.
Abel, so great to see you, man.
So we were going to start with a rant. You had some pretty cool shades there at the beginning. I've got some over here too, but I said, it's almost like you look like a biohacker, Mark.
And I took offense to that, didn't I?
A little bit.
Yeah. The term, I think, has gotten out of hand a little bit for me. And, biohacking started out as kind of, the best intentions of everybody to achieve better health through science. But what I see happening is I see sort of this trend toward, well, give me a shortcut. Like, give me something I can do so I don't have to do the work, where I don't have to put the time in, where I don't have to make any of the sacrifices. And, you know, so I see it in some of the equipment that's out there now. Get the results of 3 hours of running or 2.5 hours of cycling in 10 minutes on this bike with a wrapped forearm chilling device or something, you know. And I just, at some point, I think, you know, you kind of have to do the work and you have to understand the mechanism by which the body adapts. So, you know, people, you know, taking ketone supplements into ketosis, right? It's like your pee strip's going to be purple or your blood ketone level is going to be 0.5 or 0.6 millimolar, but that's not the point. That's not the point of this whole keto thing. So anyway, and then I'm like the anti-quantifiable self. So I don't have any of the wearables. I have this one thing that I wear that tells me where the sun is when I'm indoors.
Yeah.
But that's about it, right? So I don't track my heart rate. I don't track my, my sleep schedule that much. I wake up in the morning, I feel good, or I don't. I know intuitively, how to go about my day based on the feedback I get immediately from this thing we call a body.
Yeah. And I was having a conversation recently as well, where it's so interesting that we're all thrown, if there's any self-improvement involved or if there's any performance monitoring and that geeking out, then all of a sudden you're a hacker, which to me, coming from the music space, sounds like hack. So I've always I also take somewhat offense to the term, but the point is that should be normalized. Not, you know, we shouldn't all be thrown into the bucket of hacks if we're trying to better ourselves. Like, I do realize that the general population is running off a cliff as usual, but I think there needs to be more space for us to say, okay, we don't have to be complete weirdo, obsessive, OCD, quantified self people. We can just try to get better and be more intuitive about it as well. It's not
absolutely. I think the whole thing about intuition is critical, and that's what I've tried to teach my whole career, which is I'm going to give you some insights into how the body works. I'm going to give you some insights into how genes turn on or off in response to certain behaviors or certain foods or certain. I'm going to give you these hidden genetic switches. I'm going to give you access to them. And with your understanding, you can make choices. But, you know, not to go too deep into the term hack, it's just I don't like the term because it sort of has this connotation of shortcut. You know, if I said, well, the best way to lose weight is probably to spend, you know, 3 weeks in ketosis and then develop metabolic flexibility so you can, you know, go back to a more normalized diet. People say, well, that's a hack. Well, no, that's not really a hack. That's what humans did for 2.5 million years. They ate and then they didn't eat, you know, and so calling it a hack is a little bit of a, more of a misnomer. And I think it glosses over what we're really trying to do here, which is achieve better health.
And just show up every day and do the work, which is also being missed. I think the early adopters of paleo and ancestral health and primal were a unique kind that wasn't necessarily consistent as the years went on. And so, like, as we cast this wider net, it's interesting to see what messages stay there and which ones kind of get missed. But the put in the work is definitely one where, you know, thinking back to those paleo conferences in Austin back in, like, what, 2012, a lot of those people showed up either already having written books and blogs like you, but more often having lost 40 pounds or 150 pounds because they'd already been doing this for years. It just, they felt alone and now there are people. And so I'm interested in hearing from you, Mark. How do you feel like, you know, coming out of this past year, we could rebuild community and keep kind of maintain the right parts of the message, especially of ancestral health?
Well, in terms of ancestral health, I mean, the community has, I think, only gotten stronger through COVID because we've sort of coalesced into this group that's now taking a stance and saying, look, this is not a public health issue. This is a personal health issue. This is about your, you know, achieving some robust immune response so that you don't get taken down by this thing which is basically just a version of the flu that affects some people more than others. I don't want to, you know, belittle that. But, you know, if you have a strong immune system, this is something that you can handle quite easily, I think. And I, you know, I had COVID, I had it back in November, and it was, you know, it was like the mildest summer cold I ever had. And that was the end of it. I did lose smell and taste for a week. That was a little freaky, but that came back. And, you know, and like I say, I've been training for COVID my whole life.
Right.
And so I think in our community, I feel like there's been a real kind of, you know, nudge, nudge, wink, wink, among ourselves that, you know, we have done well. In fact, in the early days, I went to Peter Attia and I went to Paul Saladino, and I said, hey, we should enlist volunteers for a longitudinal study that'll take a year and see how many people who are actually, you know, eating according to or living according to these ancestral health guidelines, see how they fare versus the general population. We never got around to doing that, but I suspect that that you know, many people in our community who did get COVID, you know, fared quite well as a result of the training, the life training that they've done.
Yeah, and to your point, every once in a while we have to ask ourselves, why are we training? And this is why, right? Isn't it to have a more robust shields against outside attackers, whatever that might be, but also to be more resilient against whatever life throws at you? And so this,
yeah, you know, Laird Hamilton was a friend of mine. You know, we were having a discussion one day, and I'm like, you know, all the stuff you do in the pool, Laird, and all the stuff with weights, and all of the weird, you know, sort of out there training that you do, that's to be able to survive, you know, getting tossed off a big wave, right? And he goes, no, it's life training. Mm-hmm. You know, if a wave is part of that, then yes, but I don't do it specifically for that reason. I do all this training because it's part of training for life in general. And I thought that was great.
And especially now we're seeing that health is a survival skill. That's how I think of it. It's a responsibility to yourself and those around you to make sure that you have your stuff together, to make sure that you can get through some hard stuff, because no matter how well you train, life is going to throw you curveballs, and you have to train for those too. That's why training fasted, which I know maybe we can go there next, is so powerful, because when life does get hard, it's not usually when you're well fed and well rested and everything is hunky dory. It's when things are.
Isn't it interesting how it works that way?
Yeah, right? Yeah. So let's talk about fasted training, and maybe that's an inroads to talking about two meals a day, skipping breakfast or what have you. But fasted training, know you're a huge fan. How come?
You know, I just, because I've been the fat burning beast for a long time, and that was, you and I, you know, we talked about what that meant, 12 years ago?
10, long time 11 ago, years? Yeah.
Long time ago. And, you know, it's sort of, it was kind of the premise behind the Primal Blueprint, and go from a, you know, a sugar burner into a fat burner and becoming fat adapted and then becoming keto adapted. And over the years, I was quite clear that my training was, you know, somewhat centered around mealtime and the notion that I was going to have a tank full of glycogen in my muscles. And God forbid that I didn't eat after the workout, and I would go into cannibal mode and cannibalize all the muscle tissue that I was just trying to build. And over the years, as I did the research and looked further and further into, you know, how the body responds to meals and how it responds to lack of meals and what happens to the genes, and they upregulate in the absence of certain ones that upregulate in the absence of food. It became sort of clear to me that that it was not only possible to train while fasted, it was probably preferable in many cases to train while fasted. Now, sometimes there is a reason to train with a pre-workout meal or a post-workout meal if you're a bodybuilder and you're trying to just put on, you know, just mass and size. But if you're trying to become a more efficient runner or cyclist, or if you're trying to improve your power to weight ratio, then the more work that you can do burning fat and less dependent on sugar and carbohydrate, you know, the better off you are, the more you're going to build this metabolic flexibility that we talk about. And the long-term benefits are not just trending toward an ideal body composition where you lose body fat. You also build or retain some muscle. You have the energy to perform the tasks that you need to perform as an athlete. But also maybe there's some repair that takes place. This is one of the interesting things about fasting that's kind of emerged in the science in the last couple of years, is that all the good things happen to the body when we're not eating. And so that's when the body does its housekeeping, and it eats it, you know, consumes damaged protein and damaged fats within the cell. It does cell repair at the DNA level. It sometimes gets rid of senescent cells entirely. And this is a good thing when it comes to not just health today, but also in terms of longevity and your ability to maybe avoid getting cancerous cells that get started somewhere in your body. Certainly in terms of shoring up the immune system. So the idea of fasted workouts started with me just an experiment. Like, can I do it? And am I gonna cannibalize my muscle tissue because I didn't eat right before the workout? And the answer was no. Not only did I not cannibalize muscle tissue, but you know, in some cases, I could argue that the body's response to the fasted workout was maybe a larger pulse of testosterone and growth hormone. And the fact that you don't eat, I did not eat after a workout, which normally if you eat after a workout, there's a rise in insulin. Insulin then shuts off. It sort of blunts this growth hormone and testosterone pulse. So maybe there's a reason that not only working out fasted, but then not eating for a couple of hours after a workout is the ideal way to train, at least for me. And I've found for a lot of people that now it's sort of it's a habit. It's become something that people do. They look forward to it. They don't like the feeling of food in their stomach when they're working out. And I'm talking about even when they're working out like hard, like doing on a heavy leg day or a long. Today I was out riding my fat bike on the sand and on the beach here in Miami Beach, hour and 20 minutes, and it was hot. And it was grueling and it was fantastic. And I didn't like. There was no point when I thought to myself, geez, I wish I had a Snickers bar.
Right. Yes. But a lot of people who haven't built that machinery haven't experienced that feeling of not needing anything from the outside world every couple hours.
And you have to build the machinery. And that's, again, when we talk about doing the work, you have to start with a diet. And in many cases, the diet is what kind of begins the process of reconfiguring your metabolism in a way that you upregulate enzyme systems that take fat out of storage and burn fat. You increase the amount of mitochondria. It's called mitochondrial biogenesis. The mitochondria themselves become more efficient at what they do at the throughput of fat to convert it to energy. So the more, the less, in this case, the less calories in general, but typically the less sugar you consume, the more your body starts to depend on its fat stores and go, I guess if we're going to do this on a regular basis, we better start really building this machinery. And it doesn't take long. It's a couple of weeks and the body really starts to kick in with this sort of adaptation to a new diet. Once you've developed this metabolic machinery, once you've built this metabolic flexibility, and now the body can get energy out of the fat on your stored on your body, over your belly or your hips or your thighs. It can get energy out of the fat on your plate of food, or the glycogen in your muscles, or the glucose in your bloodstream, carbohydrate on your plate of food, even the ketones that your liver makes. And so it becomes metabolically flexible and efficient so that now when you decide you're going to skip a meal, there's no alarm that goes off in the brain. Oh my God, where's my glucose? The brain just goes, hey, I know how to burn ketones. I'm good at it. The muscles go, hey, I'm pretty good at burning fat now. I can get 85, 90% of my energy requirements at a high rate of output just from fat, just from triglycerides, or fatty acids. So that adaptation, once it kicks in and you're metabolically flexible, now you can play around with skipping one or two meals. Now you can play around with working out fasted and seeing how much work you can actually do. And people are, impress themselves with how much energy they have through a workout that previously they would have assumed they had to have a giant stack of pancakes or, some big energy drink or something.
Yeah, it's helped me enormously in terms of running, because having that gear where you just don't need anything is amazing. You can throw it into overdrive, or you can kick into sweet potato mode whenever you want to, which is like a secret weapon at that point, but you're not reliant on that. And especially being out here in the mountains, we live in rural Colorado up at 8,000 feet. And I love going 5, even 10 miles out sometimes. And you just don't have wonderful, luxurious dinners waiting for you up there. Anyway, you got to get back first. And which actually brings me up to another point that you raise in the book, where after you get back, for me, from like a hard run where I'll do some hill sprints and then I'll go up in the mountains a little bit, or after heavy weight training, you're not hungry for a bit. A lot of times you are trying to choke down those carbs or that protein right away against your own intuition.
Yeah. And I mean, that's your body telling you something, right? That's your body saying, look, you know, we really don't... Conversely, you would think that once you finish something like that, if it were truly beneficial to you to consume a lot of calories, your body would be ravenous and wanting to do it. But this loss of appetite, I think it serves a purpose. And it's allowing the body to, again, do all the cool things that it does in the absence of fuel, or in the absence of energy present in the bloodstream at that time, because it's doing this repair, maintenance, housekeeping, and all the things, all the good things that is that go on that we are wired to do. We've just sort of forgotten how to do it because of, you know, this comfy life that we live and this easy access to food and all of the habituation. It's not even addiction as much as it's habituation for a lot of people. Like they don't even listen to their appetite or their hunger. They're just sort of, well, it's, you know, I just ran, you know, an hour and 10 minutes and it's close to lunch. I better have lunch, you know, and as opposed to, wow, I feel great. I feel energetic. I feel clear thinking and I'm not hungry. That must be a signal.
Yeah. I've also noticed wearing a CGM, like tracking my levels of glucose when I am working out fasted, I've got plenty. Even if I'm out for that 10 miler or something that should be, you know, oh, are you going to bonk or something like that? No, I'll fast until 3:30. I'll go out for a long run. Sometimes I'll come back. I won't even be hungry. And when I look at the readings, I have my glucose readings are higher on my fasted workouts than they are during my refeed with like straight up glucose from coconut water and a couple slices of sourdough or whatever it is. I found that to be really fascinating.
That's cool. That's the body. Again, the body makes glucose enough, you know, whatever you need, the body will make it if you fine tune that machinery, if you have built that metabolic flexibility.
And so you also talked about metabolic efficiency. And I saw you on Rogan, which was really entertaining to watch. But I think he talked about how you're eating less, like considerably less than a few years ago, 4 or 5 years ago, right?
Yeah. I mean, one of the things that I realized with the metabolic flexibility is also there comes a thing called metabolic efficiency. And as the mitochondria become more efficient in the ability to burn fat, stored body fat, improves, you're literally able to do more with fewer calories. And it's not that your body is somehow, downshifting in its metabolic requirements. It's that in the past you were probably overeating and getting away with it. Yeah. So if you really do the math, you'd say, well, how much, you know, what does it take to run a body through a course of a day? You know, you shouldn't really even assign a caloric value to protein, right? You don't want to combust protein. Protein is there. Amino acids are there to be used largely in the building of tissue or enzymes. You can make some glucose out of some of the amino acids through gluconeogenesis, but it's not really the intention of most of the protein we take in. So the protein, 40 grams, 50 grams a day is probably all the body needs for maintenance. If you're burning a lot of body fat, if you have a high rate of throughput with body fat, you can get several hundred or several thousand calories a day worth of body fat. And if you're cutting the carbs, you don't even need that much in the way of carbs. So if you've gotten this fine-tuned metabolism, you probably don't need that much in the way of of caloric intake. Now, I looked at my own past, and when I was a runner and I weighed 30 pounds less than I weigh now, and I was consuming 6,000 calories a day. And running 20 miles in a big day, that's only 2,000 calories. So where'd the other 4,000 calories go, right?
Running it hot.
Well, running hot. So the body, I was lucky. I didn't get fat, because a lot of people just take that excess calories and store it. But in my case, my body was running hot. It was revving high. It was burning off, trying to find ways. They call it the thermic effect of food and thermogenesis. And, you know, it was trying to, and I slept hot every night. I mean, I would sweat all night long in my sleep. That was my body getting rid of excess calories that it did not want to store as fat. And it did not want the excess calories floating around in the bloodstream. And so it was finding whatever way it could to burn them off. Well, that's a little bit like, I read, down in Texas when you guys had that cold snap, some of the fuel lines were burning off excess gas, even though nobody could get the gas to their homes. These oil fields were burning off, billions of BTUs of gas, sort of unnecessarily, just to get rid of it. Because they couldn't do anything with it. So if that's the case, then a lot of us are eating more than we should. A lot of us are getting away with eating a lot of calories that we don't really need. Our bodies are either storing it as fat in some cases, or in the case of myself and maybe the case of you, finding ways to rev up the metabolism and burn it off. But a high metabolism is not a good thing. It's not necessarily a good thing. It's like, why do you want a high? Why do you want a fast metabolism? I go to the gym and I talk to guys who are training their asses off, doing two-a-days and doing treadmill stuff. And like, why are you working out so much? And the answer is quite often, well, because I like to eat and I want to deserve what I eat. And I'm like, well, I like to eat too, but I don't want to be a glutton. I don't want to struggle and suffer in the gym just so I can eat more bites of something I probably shouldn't have in the first place.
Yeah.
It's a weird kind of mindset that people have. So with that assumption that we generally, most of us, eat too much food, and we eat to the point of what can I get away with? How much food can I eat and not gain weight? How much dessert can I have and not feel like a pig or a glutton? I did a little bit of a thought experiment. I thought, well, let's do a kind of a Tim Ferriss approach to this. What's the minimum effective dose of food? What's the least amount of food I can eat and maintain muscle mass and have all the energy I want and not get sick, and most importantly, not get hungry? Because I don't want anybody to get hungry. We're not talking about forced starving. I'm just talking about what's the least amount of food that I can eat and accomplish all those goals and not be hungry. And that's when I realized, Jesus, it's like 30% fewer calories than I used to eat. It's one full meal. And that's sort of where the two meals a day concept came from. It's like, I'm not saying that you don't eat for 18 hours and then you eat in two meals what you would have eaten in three.
Right.
I'm saying you don't eat for 18 hours or 16 or whatever your number is. And then you only eat two of the meals you used to eat, and you're just cutting out a meal. And I was going to call the book one and a half meals a day, but it was a little too daunting. I want to start with two, and then I'll tell you, look, if you can get away with only eating one and a half meal a day,
that'll be the sequel. The sequel.
Do it. Yeah, exactly.
The numbers.
It'll be two meals a day, 2.0, which is 1.5, whatever.
Have to add a fraction in there or something. Yeah. But I think the point is that most of us just take for granted that we're kind of eating all day and that culture around us is also eating all day. And that shouldn't be normal. It's not historically normal.
Yeah, it's only normal because we've become habituated to it. It's only normal because, Madison Avenue and Big Food made it very clear that breakfast was the most important meal of the day, that cereal, that 11, 6 to 11 servings of grains, and particularly cereal in the morning, was good for kids, that a day without oranges or orange juice is a day without sunshine. That was the Florida, orange boards thing that Anita Bryant did for years and years. And so we've been thoroughly ingrained into thinking that we need to have breakfast because that's the most important meal of the day. Get off to a good start. Noon time is lunchtime. And there's an evening meal. And then for a lot of people, there's a snack. There's a 10 a.m., 10:30 a.m. coffee break with a donut mid-morning. There's an afternoon break. There's, you know, evening TV, snack time. And it's become kind of a ridiculous notion that we spend the whole freaking day eating. But it's habituation. It's habituation. And if you can, if through, you know, my book, and you read this book and you understand that if I can make you very comfortable by eating much less, if you could be like not only just very comfortable, but that you will choose to do it, that you will thrive and feel like not only do I feel better, do I have more energy, but I actually enjoy every bite of food I eat even more now than I did before. And I know when I'm full and I know when I'm satisfied and I know when I'm satiated and I can stop. Then I think that's a really, really empowering, that's going to be empowering for so many people who are otherwise now tethered to their daily habitual eating routine.
Yeah. And it's interesting how defensive people get about eating less, or the idea that you or I might eat less. There are just like so many defensive responses to that. But the attacks that they come with are just like, aren't you damaging your metabolism forever? And it's funny how that isn't reversed on the other side when you're, you know, like pounding through 4,000 to 6,000 calories of pizza and bagels and tortillas and all the rest of this junk. Usually you don't get to look on the other side of that. But if you're eating less, which has also happened with me, I'd say about 25-30%, something like that. That wasn't true in my 20s, but more in my 30s, I found like, oh, I can get away with way less. And it actually doesn't affect my body composition or strength. I can still gain strength if I want to. It's not as related as I thought it was.
Yeah, it's not related in the way you thought it was, for sure. It wasn't this equation that basically said the more protein I eat and the more calories I take in, the more muscle I'll build. It, you know, the body is basically operating more from a hormonal input and signaling perspective than it is from just shoveling fuel into the tank and hoping that stuff gets built. So, you know, when you, again, like example, what I would use is when I was a runner and I would carb load every day. I mean, because as a runner, you know, because one of the thought processes is that to be an elite runner, you have to train every single day. So I ran 100 miles a week for years. And some days I'd run 10 miles hard. Some days I'd run 20 miles. Some days I'd do 15 in the morning and 6 in the afternoon. And it was a brutal lifestyle, which I willingly engaged in. But the assumption in that day was you have to burn, you know, it's so based on glycogen, and you have to fill the tanks up that you have to consume at least 600 grams of carbs every day in order to do that. And the irony there is that was true because I wasn't developing my fat burning skills through manipulating my diet and manipulating my training. I wasn't developing fat burning skills. So I was reliant on carbohydrate and sugar. And the joke there is, yes, and I did deplete carbs every day, and I did need to carb load every night because I was going to go have to do it again the next day.
Right.
Right. So there was this kind of self-fulfilling prophecy there about running out of glycogen and having to carb load and then not being good at burning fat because I had so much glycogen and was consuming so much carbs. I never really tapped into my fat stores. You know, and I did. I mean, let's be clear. I was an elite runner, so I was burning some fat. But I was so reliant on the carbs that, you know, you take a guy like Zach Bitter now who gets 97% of his energy requirements when he's running 650 a mile from fat. This was something that years ago the science community didn't think was even possible.
Right.
You know, even with keto, even Finney and Volek, I think didn't these, you know, the two guys who kind of pioneered that whole thing, they didn't think it was possible that you could derive that much energy at that high a level of output just from fat. So it's pretty interesting the adaptations that happen as a result of all of this. And as I said, part of it's the diet and reconfiguring the diet and restricting or withholding. glucose, carbohydrates, and part of it is the training. And so when I was a runner, I trained in what we call the black hole, which was, it was not slow enough to be burning at the optimal fat burning level, but not fast enough to be developing high-end sustained power. So all I was doing was in this middle zone of 80 to 92% of my max heart rate, day in and day out, practicing to hurt and not really improving, right? So there was a, you know, if I could go back and do it again, first of all, if I could go back and do it again, I wouldn't even do it because I'd pick a different, I'd pick a fun sport.
We're thankful that you suffered on our
path. Yeah, no, I learned a lot and I was able to pass it along, and I'm hoping I can help my friends avoid some of the pitfalls that I encountered.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, anyway, I just see there are so many wins from eating less, becoming more metabolically efficient. You get less cleanup, less to buy, less just nagging throughout the day of oh, I need to eat now. I see it as just, you know, a total backup wonderful skill to have, that you can go dinner to dinner or even longer without really breaking a sweat or worrying about it.
Yeah, I mean, it's certainly a time-saving thing. And it's also part of the empowerment comes, again, if you find yourself in a situation where you're going to skip a meal that you were otherwise going to have or had planned to have, or you're traveling, or, you know, you've got a meeting that runs late. One of the things that I haven't, focused on until very recently is, let's say you're in a meeting and it's a tough negotiation and a meeting's running into lunchtime, and you're the adversarial part of the negotiation says we should break for lunch. And you go, nah, let's go right through lunch and take advantage of that.
Yeah.
That mismatch in energy. I'm kidding. That's not true. But anyway, it's the empowerment of being able to make it through the day and not be tethered to mealtime and not feel like you're going to get hangry or you're going to lose, you know, focus, or you're going to lose energy, or you're going to whatever. It's a pretty cool skill to have. And it's an eminently human skill.
Yeah. And also you've turned down the noise on the salads a little bit, right? Where...
Yeah, that's one of the things that I've really shifted in the past few years. You know, I was pretty much a salad a day kind of guy, Mark's big ass salad, and I also felt that was too much food. And how I noticed that was the size of my big ass salad was getting smaller and smaller, and I couldn't even call it a big ass salad anymore. It was just a salad. So, and then I've gotten to the point where I used to have one a day. I maybe have literally one a week now.
Wow. Interesting. So it's especially, yeah, for us in the West, in Colorado, especially, sometimes it's really hard to get those fresh greens.
Yeah, no, it's always easy for me to get greens. I'm in a part of the country where there's not, I'm either in California or in Florida where that's not a deal breaker, but for me, it's more of my evolution as a student of the human body and listening to guys like Paul Saladino and Sean Baker, who are espousing this, you know, carnivore diet, which I at first viewed with some skepticism, like how can you go long periods of time without eating vegetables or fruits? Isn't that contrary to the human experience, and isn't that contrary to good health? You know, the more I look into it, the more I realize that there's something going on there. There's something with these carnivore diets, especially if you eat nose to tail, where you're not consuming what they would argue are toxic phytochemicals, right? Their argument would be that plants don't want to be eaten. They can't run away. It's not like fruits, which fruits typically want to be eaten because they depend on animals consuming them to deposit the seeds elsewhere in fecal matter. But plants in general, green plants and leafy greens and stuff, they really don't want to be eaten. And as Saladino would say, so many green plants are poisonous. Like there aren't even like more, there are more poisonous plants than there are non-poisonous plants. Mm-hmm. So, you know, what is it about about modern dietary science that would continue to promote lots of leafy greens and fruits and vegetables as the base of a healthy diet. And I'm not saying it shouldn't be, but I'm saying I've become more interested in the rationale behind that and the science behind that. And one of the things that came up early on was the idea that, well, you need the fiber. So if you're not going to eat grains, because grains are a good source of fiber, then you definitely need to eat fruits and vegetables, because where else you're going to get your fiber? And the assumption was that you need fiber. So it's like, where are you going to get your fiber? And what if you don't need fiber? What if all of the material that your gut bacteria need to thrive on is contained within the healthy versions of the meat products, the animal products that you're consuming? And it turns out that collagen, for instance, is a very good substrate for gut bacteria. And so you don't really need the fermentation of leafy vegetables making their way down the undigested fiber, you know, the insoluble fiber that makes its way down the colon isn't necessary for the good health of beneficial bacteria at all. And if you go even deeper, if you dig even deeper, you realize that the colon is just basically where 100 trillion foreign invaders live, right? There, 100 trillion bacteria live in your colon. Some of them are benefiting you, but a lot of them are just there for the ride.
Right.
You could argue that bacteria evolved humans as a life support system. if you really wanted to get wacky out there, right? But at any rate, what my point is that really fecal matter shouldn't really be much more than just dead bacteria, just bacterial turnover. That if these bacteria, if 100 trillion of them are dividing every couple of hours or every couple of days, and they're dying, and they need to pass out the body, that's the main substance of fecal matter. And the fact that undigested food happens to find its way in there, that could be partly due to the fact that you haven't taken care of your digestive tract in the first place, or that you haven't, you know, that your stomach acid isn't strong enough, or that you have leaky gut syndrome, or that you have other aspects of your gut that are not performing well in terms of breaking down the food products. And so you're passing a lot of that food out in your stool, which you think is a good thing because it's scrubbing the lining of your colon, when in fact that's not only not necessary, that's probably damaging.
Yeah. From an intuitive standpoint, looking at what can you kick out of your diet without missing it too much, I found as well, just like being on the road, like going without greens, having some powdered greens or something, maybe, like, but I don't totally need those either. But I don't totally miss the salad. But if I don't have protein, like if I don't have a legit source of meat, eggs, maybe cheese, something like that, man, do I miss that fast.
Yeah. And you know, you and I would argue that if you flip that around and you say, okay, so for a vegan or a vegetarian who only eats vegetable matter and doesn't eat meat, and you and I are sort of recognizing that the one thing we would miss in our diet is meat, is animal products, is protein, is the thing that keeps us together. And that's by definition what's missing from a vegan's diet. It's crazy. It's crazy how adaptive the human body can be to certain diets. Now, having said that, there's never been a race of people, a tribe, an ethnicity of any kind that's survived solely on a vegan diet. Yeah, there are individuals within those places and so on, but not any hunter-gatherer society where you said, you know, we notice you've been eating a lot of plants recently, is that your main diet? They're probably going to say, well, that's just because that's what's available. But if we had some damn meat, man, we would be all over that, right? They wouldn't willingly say no thanks for the meat. We'll stick with our stems and seeds.
Yeah, and now ruminants, regenerative ruminants are getting a good rap, at least in some circles, which I'm
really. Oh my God. Well, in our circles for sure.
Yeah.
I mean, we've been following this for a long time. Since Alan Savory started writing about it, Joel Salatin at Polyface Farms. I mean, this is how we feed the world. We feed the world with ruminant beasts. We feed the world by growing ruminants, feeding them grass, eating their meat, using their fecal matter to trample the ground and create topsoil so that we can also grow green leafy vegetables and other healthier forms of food than, say, corn, soy, wheat, and so on.
Yeah. I've appreciated more, too, as time has gone on and some of the red meat hysteria, at least in our circles, has gone away. Embracing that more over chicken and even fish since we've been landlocked for a while. But the amount of variety when you really do eat ruminant animals, nose to tail, and a few different kinds of them. Like out here, we live by a yak ranch, and we've got goats.
I love it.
And all sorts of stuff. And yeah. So,
do you guys get yak butter and yak cheese?
We get some weird stuff out here. Yeah, we have yak burgers over there. They're actually, some people don't like them, but I like the flavor. I'm a fan of yak. But you can have a lot of fun with a variety eating that way, as opposed to how much would you really miss chicken, especially if you couldn't put any olive oil on it, if you couldn't add fat to it.
Can you believe that 20 years ago, the healthiest meal you could eat was skinless chicken breast?
Right. It's so grim. It's so grim.
Grim is a great way to describe it. Oh, by the way, that was with white rice too, typically. But and no butter on the white rice, just white rice and skinless, boneless chicken breast was sort of the go-to meal for the healthy set. My, how times have changed. And to your point, I don't eat chicken much at all anymore. I would abide it. I would be okay with it. But now I almost go out of my way not to eat chicken anymore. I do eat a lot of fish still, but and mostly red meat. Yeah.
And we have to do a tip of the hat, absolutely, to some of your sauces, which I think for people who are intimidated by cooking meats or vegetables, one of the most intimidating things is what spices do I use? You know, how do I make it taste good? And how do I make it taste different? How do I make sure I'm not eating the same thing every day after day? And this is such an easy inroads for a lot of people who aren't necessarily skilled in the kitchen, but even those who are, to get rolling with that.
Yeah, well, I realized a long time ago that if I were to clean my diet up, if I were to get rid of sugars and processed grains and industrial seed oils, I'd come down to a fairly short list of, beef, pork, lamb, chicken, turkey, fish, 17 vegetables. I dare you to name me more.
Right, it gets harder.
And what really makes the difference, if that's what you're going to be consuming on a regular basis, 90% of the time, what makes the difference are the sauces, the dressings, the toppings, the herbs, the spices, the methods of preparation. That's what gives all of these things variety. That's what gives them an infinite number of ways to prepare them. That's what allows for 1,000 cookbooks in the paleo ancestral space.
Yeah.
There's lots of ways to make that relatively limited list of real food taste incredible. And what I realized was I didn't have the time to make the sauces myself. And I wanted a place that I could go to purchase sauces and salad dressings and barbecue sauces, condiments, mayonnaise, ketchup, things that you put on food to make it taste better, but that didn't ruin the food by virtue of the fact that you were putting them on them. Mm-hmm. It started with my complete dissatisfaction with salad dressings. I would go to the store, and when I was doing my big ass salad, I would go to the store and I'd be appalled at all of the dressings, virtually all of the dressings, they had soy or corn oil or canola oil as the main ingredient in them. And I just didn't want to put that in my body. And by the way, in the last 5 years, there's been a real resurgence of like, get rid of those industrial seed oils. They might be worse than sugar. So we came up with a line of product. It's called Primal Kitchen, and we make an avocado oil-based mayonnaise, avocado oil-based salad dressings, some amazing pasta sauces, barbecue sauces. Ketchup is our ketchup is one of my favorite, is my favorite of our products.
Yeah, it's fantastic.
And it makes just, you know, eating healthy that much more fun and exciting.
And convenient, because like even if you do know how to make it, it's like you're not going to make your curry from scratch after you've had a long work day. You know, even the people who do, you know, have a lot of fun in the kitchen. It's just so, so great to have something in a bottle that you can trust. That's like a combination of something that tastes good, but also different. And before, really, before you led the way with that on a mass scale, the other companies weren't doing that. It was so hard to find. And so you had so many people, and some continue to do this, eating that a big ass salad with a horrible, you know, dressing that's probably 1200 calories or something like that, where they could just as easily, boom, you know, kick out that meal or push it a little later in the day and go for that big hunk of nose to tail meat.
Yeah, I found that to be tragic. The fact that people would put together an amazing salad with 12 different, you know, forms of bib lettuce and regular lettuce and daikon and, you know, radishes and mushrooms and all kinds of cool stuff in there. And then, like you say, ruin it, literally ruin it, turn it from a wonderfully healthy bowl of nutrition into a, you know, into a fat bomb that had linoleic acid and high omega-6 content just written all over it.
How about one more quick thing to talk about the sprints and just giving people the permission to have luxurious, what was it? Luxurious rest periods, recovery periods.
Yeah. So, in the last couple of years, again, almost out of necessity, Brad Kearns, my co-author and I, you know, we're pioneering some, ideas like how could we work through a day without getting sweaty, but without having to go change into a, you know, a workout outfit, but still get a workout done. And we started doing these micro workouts. So the micro workout is basically just, you know, if you're at your desk and you decide I'll do 50 air squats right now, it's not enough to really sweat, and I'll stop and I'll go back to work. I don't need to, you know, rest 90 seconds and then do 50 more and rest 90 seconds and 50 more. So we basically thought, well, what if you broke a 35 or a 45 minute workout up into, you know, 10 different micro workouts throughout the day, none of which was enough to get you gassed or sweaty, but all of which when put together, you did the work. You actually created some response to that was going to build muscle or make you stronger and make you more powerful. And that applies to sprints too. So, you know, the idea that in the old days as a runner, you know, your sprints had to be, you had to be still slightly tired as you went into the next sprint rather than fully recovered.
Yeah.
Right. Especially if you were a distance runner, not so much if you're a sprinter. If you're a sprinter, it was great. These guys would go to the track, they'd warm up and they'd chat and they'd smile and laugh and stretch and tell jokes and then do a jog or two around the track and then do one sprint and then go back and stretch and joke and talk. And then 10 minutes later, get up and do another sprint. And they would literally rest completely in between these sprint sessions. And they got faster. And that's because the idea wasn't to load on as much work as you could do. The idea was to get better, to improve. And one of the ways to improve was to do the work as hard as you could, because sprinters do that, and then completely, you know, rest for 5 minutes, 6 minutes, 7 minutes, 10 minutes, whatever, and then do it again and not go into the next repetition only 90% recovered or only 80% recovered. We found some utility in that in our prescribing these micro workouts throughout the day. And of course, with COVID, it was perfect for people who were homebound, who could, you know, couldn't get to the gym, but could certainly drop and do 20 push-ups right now and then get back to their Zoom call or typing and then do it again in a half an hour. And it turns out that that's probably a legitimate way of improving your fitness and health by taking even longer to recover in between these little micro workouts.
And man, it feels better. It feels so much better when you can actually not be gassed by the time you're starting the next one, dreading it. Cause Like if I get myself enough dress, I'm kind of psyched for the next one.
Yeah.
Yeah, let's
exactly.
Do it.
Exactly. Yeah.
But it takes a while. All right. So Mark, what is the best place to find your work, Two Meals a Day, your new book, as well as Primal Kitchen and all the rest of it?
Well, Two Meals a Day, you know, Amazon, everybody buys on Amazon right now. So that's, and if you go to a bookstore, it'll be in bookstores as well. And then Mark's Daily Apple is the blog, written something there every day for 15 years now, 2006 to 2021.
Congrats. Yeah, 2006.
Yeah. Yeah, crazy. And then Primal Kitchen, you know, the food line. Highly encourage you if you haven't tried these sauces and dressings and toppings. They're fantastic, if I do say so myself. I'm Mark Sisson Primal on Instagram, and there's an occasional shirtless shot of me there. So
doing something.
I took a year off. I took a year off and didn't post anything, but I think I'm gonna start up again.
There we go. Well, Mark, it's always such a pleasure to catch up with you. Thanks for taking the time.
A pleasure to be with you, Abel. Take care.
Hey, it's Abel one last time, and I just want to say thank you for listening to this episode of Fat Burning Man. Before you go, please smash that like button, hit subscribe, or even leave us a quick review. It helps so much more than you even realize. And if you can think of someone else who you care about, friend, family member, anyone else who might appreciate this free show, then please take a quick second just to share it with them. Word of mouth is really the way that we've grown this show over the years. We have more than, at this point, 4 awards in independent media, 50 million downloads. We couldn't do any of this without you, so we really appreciate it. If you'd like to get in touch with me, then please follow me under Abel James or Fat Burning Man on your social media platform of choice, and I'll do my best to get right back to you. Now, if you want to keep this show coming to you, you can do something really quickly here. My wife Allison and I, along with a very small team, depend on listeners like you to make this show happen week after week. To join our next challenge, coaching group, or get in touch with me one-on-one, visit fatburningman.com. We also make group coaching free with your subscribe and save orders from our family company, Wild Superfoods, which you can find at wildsuperfoods.com. And if you'd like, you can throw a few bucks into the tip jar as a one-time donation or become a contributing member of our group on Patreon. Just look up Abel James on Patreon and you can join in the fun for as little as a few bucks and get my international best-selling book and audiobook as a special thanks. You can also find that page at fatburningman.com/tipjar. Now, a quick disclaimer for all those legal eagles out there. The Fat Burning Man Show provides general information and discussions about health and related subjects. The information provided in this show or in any related materials are not intended and should not be construed as medical advice, nor is the information a substitute for professional medical expertise, diagnosis, or treatment. The opinions and views expressed on this show have no relation to those of any academic, hospital, health practice, or other institution, including corporate overlords. We don't have any of those. If you or any other person has a medical concern, I wholeheartedly encourage you to consult with your healthcare provider. Whew! Okay. Don't forget to join our newsletter over at fatburningman.com. When you sign up for our email, I'll even send you a wild quick start guide along with a few of our ridiculously tasty recipes, even Allison's famous chocolate nut cookies, as a special thanks for signing up. This is Abel James signing off. Thank you so much for listening and have a great week.